best of Stand With Us and Irene Naftalin, and I just want to give them a plug because they do such fantastic work on the campuses around the country. They deserve the applause because they're right in the front line. They have this uncomfortable job of combating boycott movements and anti-Israel rhetoric, and Stand With Us gives them the ammunition, gives them the information on which they can fight this, and they do it remarkably successfully. And we have student leaders on most campuses, or many campuses around the country, who gather around them teams of people who can really be effective. So they're well worth supporting. There are some information about them at the back. So I'm pleased to talk about Balfour on their behalf in this centenary year. I'm going to talk about the historical background of the Balfour Declaration, what it was, what it wasn't, and the implications for today. And there's an enormous amount of misunderstanding about what it was, and there's certainly divided opinion in the general public. There are those on one side who think it was the biggest error of judgment that a government could make, and those on the other who feel that it was the most magnanimous gesture of an imperial nation for a persecuted people. Balfour himself would have been amazed that 100 years later that there'd still be a conflict about this small notch of land. Small notch of land is the words he used on the Mediterranean. When I visited Israel last year, I took a group of peers from the House of Lords, and we also went to Ramallah, to the PLO office. And we met a man called Nabil Shah, who'd been one of the negotiators with Arafat. And he said to this group of largely non-Jewish peers, "It's all your fault, you Brits, for the Balfour Declaration." Well, they didn't like that at all. They argued forcibly against it. It was marvelous PR for the Israelis. Well, Balfour wasn't the first Brit to support a home for the Jews in Palestine. Way back in the middle of the 19th century, in 1840-odd, Lord Shaftesbury was trying to get most of the leading royalty around Europe to support a home for the Jews in Palestine. Very keen he was. So was Lord Palmerston, a foreign secretary, who was trying to press the Sultan in Istanbul, as Constantinople as it was then, to allow the Jews to go in, unsuccessful. And the Times in London was writing articles, 1841, a big article about Jews to return to their homeland. Of course, it wasn't true elsewhere in Europe, where anti-Semitism had changed when people became assimilated into Viennese and Berlin society. They either assimilated or converted to Christianity. Despite that, anti-Semitism changed from religious to racial persecution. But in Britain, by the time Balfour came along, we had a history of 80 years or more of at least government support. Well, let me tell you a little about this unlikely figure of Balfour, this tall, thin, aristocratic man lounging around, leaning on any convenient wall, lying almost horizontal in the benches in Parliament. He gave the impression that life was just too much. He said, "Nothing much matters, and very few things matter at all." That was he was a dazzling conversationalist. He was attractive to women, and they were attracted by him. And he was a paragon of virtue, apparently. He was more interested in philosophy and in writing books about logic and doubt and philosophy. So it was a surprise when he was made Minister for Ireland by the Prime Minister, Lord Salisbury, till it was realised that Lord Salisbury was his uncle. And Lord Salisbury's real name was Robert Cecil, and when Bob's your uncle, anything's possible. He later became Prime Minister because he did a very successful job in Ireland. He was well regarded there. He was called Bloody Balfour by the Irish, because he put them down, but he was very highly regarded, became Prime Minister for a few years, then he was out of office for a while, but the critical moment, in 1916, he was Foreign Minister in Lloyd George's wartime government. We were in the middle of the First World War. So, how come did this paragon of virtue, this aristocrat, come to support the Zionist cause? Was it guilt he felt because he passed the Aliens Act in 1904, which limited immigration from Eastern Europe and Russia, largely Jews? Was it that? Was it to reward Weizmann? Weizmann had been busy with the British government inventing a way of producing large amounts of acetone, which were very useful in the First World War for making explosives. Was it that? That's what's taught in Israeli schools, I gather. Was it to get American support, American Jewish support, to press their president to come into the war on our side? Or perhaps to place a friendly set of people, the Jews, in Palestine, to help protect the route to the Suez Canal and to India? Was it that? That was certainly Lloyd George's view, because they couldn't trust the Arab tribes. They were all vacillating between supporting Britain or supporting the Turks. But it was none of those. He was already speaking out against injustices to the Jews in Eastern Europe during the 1890s, well before the First World War. He thought Dreyfus was innocent, and he thought it was an anti-Semitic plot. So, by the time Weizmann came along, 1905, and met him, converted into Zionism, he was already predisposed to the Jews. He was already there. Let me give you some quotes that he made during some of the speeches then and later. "We can't forget how the Jews have been treated during long centuries. Our whole religious organization of Europe has proved itself guilty of great crimes against this race." And he wrote a foreword in Nahum Sokolov's book, A History of Zionism. He said, "The position of Jews is unique. For them, race, religion, and country are interrelated, as they are interrelated in the case of no other race, no other religion, and no other country on earth." So, if you're looking to try and define whether Judaism is a race, or a religion, or a nation, people debate this endlessly, look no further than what Balfour was saying. And that's why he was so supportive of the Home for the Jews in Palestine. The Declaration of 1917, we all know, was a home for the Jews, and not to prejudice the rights, the religious and civic rights of the Palestinians who lived there. No thought seems to have been given to how one group, the Jews, could protect the rights of another group, the Arabs, who were intent on killing them off. But it wasn't a treaty. Didn't have any legal basis. It was just a letter of sympathy, of support, not much more. It was official, but not, and it was official because of the government's view, but it wasn't a legal document. Most members of the government were supportive, including Lloyd George. The one who wasn't, not surprisingly, was the Duke, Edwin Montagu. Edwin Montagu was a significant figure. He was very wealthy. Very well established in the Jewish and the English community. He thought of himself first as an Englishman and then as a Jew. That wasn't the view expressed by others, incidentally, but that's what he felt. Why should I? I've got everything I want here. Why should I go and dig the land so far away in a far-off place? It's something for others, not for me, and I don't like this Balfour Declaration. But then they pushed him off to become viceroy in India, and the cabinet, meanwhile, passed the Balfour Declaration. So it wasn't just a British thing. Many people think, it was the Brits. But it had international support, even then. The French supported it. Nahum Sokolov, a great man, incidentally, you should learn more about him. Nahum Sokolov got the French to write a letter saying, yeah, you ought to put the Balfour Declaration out. Supportive letter. The French weren't terribly friendly, but he got them to do it. He also got the Italian Prime Minister to do it. He also got the Pope to do it. The Pope didn't write anything, but he was received in very friendly terms, and the Pope said, yeah, fine, we think the Jews in Palestine will be a good idea. It wasn't the previous Pope's view or the Pope after his view, but Clement agreed. But as I say, it could have got lost at any time because it wasn't a legal document. It was only in 1920, at San Remo when the British and the French carved up the Middle East into their own mandate so they could keep control of all the Middle East. And in that mandate, Britain was mandated to support a Jewish homeland. And it mentions in that document the reconstitution of the Jews to Palestine. The Balfour originally said the establishment of the Jews. Now this was reconstitution. And the Jews were mentioned as a nation no less than 20 times. So San Remo was very key. And then in 1922, the whole lot was taken up by the League of Nations as an official acceptance legally. All 51 nations voted for it and none of them against. So, and that was what was taken up by the United Nations in 1947, and that's the legal basis. Some argue about the legal basis of Israel. Does it really mean to exist? Just remember San Remo, just remember all 51 nations in the League of Nations. Now, here's the surprise. While the Palestinian Arabs always resisted Jewish immigration, the rest of the Arab world were supportive. The Grand Sheriff Hussein and his son Prince Faisal in Mecca spoke of the Jews as their brethren, and they were happy for them to enter this small, isolated area of their Arabian lands for the Jews. Their daily newspaper in Mecca spoke of the Jews as being welcome. And so it was an interesting phenomenon. They actually wrote an agreement with the British that the Jews could go into Palestine. But it was after that they realized they'd been duped by the British. The British had been talking to Hussein about giving them control of the Middle East, big Arabian lands, if they would help the Brits turf out the Turks, turf out the Ottomans. And they went along with it. They fought with the Brits at that time, more or less. Not all of them, but more or less. And they then, when the mandates were discovered, and that the mandates were going to take on the control of what they thought was their land by the Brits and by the French, dividing the land up in the way that it was, they realized they'd been duped. And they then began to see Jewish immigration as just a local symbol of colonization by the West. And typically to Jews only arose when land promised to Arabs seemed to be no longer there. Well, let me tell you about Weizmann. I haven't mentioned him yet, because he was a key figure. He was the key figure behind the Declaration, one of them. He worked with others, of course, in producing the original documentation that was, they hoped, would be formed into the Declaration. He convinced Balfour, of course, convinced Lloyd George, and he was well in with the rest of the government. Winston Churchill was supportive. So they all were favorably disposed to Weizmann. He then went on and was working behind the scenes at San Remo in the League of Nations in 1922. And he was also persuasive of President Truman in 1946-47, when he persuaded him about the partition plan, when Truman's advisors were all telling him, don't have anything to do with this Israel business, don't have anything to do with Jews in Palestine, it's not worth it. And he agreed. He followed Weizmann. He also followed Weizmann by allowing the partition plan to include the Negev Desert, which wasn't included in the original partition plan. But then the Brits began to behave very badly. And that was during the later 1920s, 1930s, certainly the 1940s. Immigration was restricted. We had the white paper, we had the partition plans. And then we needed people other than Weizmann. We needed a Ben-Gurion or a Begin to become more aggressive and to have armed resistance against the British. So the Brits fell out of favor, and so did Weizmann, because Weizmann remained a key follower of Britain. He wanted to see Britain play a bigger role, and he's working again with Britain to try and help the formation of Israel. So he fell out of favour. That bothers me a bit, because as a fellow Mancunian, he was a Mancunian at that time, I feel he's been forgotten and airbrushed a bit out of history. But there's no doubt, that without the declaration in 1917, without the support of the Brits in 1920 and 1922, it would have been very difficult for Israel to have emerged. And whatever Britain did later about immigration, about partition plan, nibbling away at the promised land, the Jewish leadership accepted what was on offer. Incidentally, I'm due to open the debate on the Balfour Declaration in the House of Lords in a couple of weeks, hoping to persuade the government to celebrate the Balfour Declaration. And the question I ask is, how will the British government mark the centenary of the Balfour Declaration? So I'm hoping that they will come up with something good, and I'll try and persuade them. So, the Jews accepted whatever was on offer, no matter how small, knowing full well they knew that they would be able to change facts on the ground. And that's what they've managed to do. Thank you very much.